Greetings, everybody. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you very much for being here tonight. I'm Rick Dressen, superintendent. I would ask us, just as I'm doing the introductions here, check those cell phones. That'd be wonderful. Bathroom facilities are right out back. And so if there is a need for that, we are not taking a break during this, but if you do need to get up and walk around a little bit, feel free to do that. This is an important night for us as a school district. It's an important night for us as a community. We live as a school district by our mission statement, and it's 47 thoughtful words that were developed in the late 80s, and we have not moved them at all. And those 47 words we like to boil down to three words: all of us working for all learners. How do we all come together to support all learners? And tonight we're all learners. So this is us coming together. And I do believe this is how we were rooted as a community. This is the Grange Hall, and if you ever go on Wikipedia, you really should and find out about the Grange Hall, because this is what helped settle Edina. Edina has always been about people coming together to learn, to voice their thoughts, their opinions, and then to get focused back on the mission. And this Grange Hall, it's one of those buildings up by Perkins right off 100, and it's an important part of our community. Because back in those days, they would come together and talk about what they needed to do to become a strong Edina community. And one of the things they put a high value on was this: education. You can go back, and we are over 157 years of this community using tax dollars to support young people. And so in that Grange Hall, I can bet they talked about learning, and they talked about how can we come together as a community. Today, we are doing the same thing as a school district. We're saying, how do we come together to prepare our young people, the people sitting right out here today, how do we make sure that they have a great life ahead of them? And so Edina has been on this journey to say, what's our next generation of learning about? How do we ensure quality learning, quality living, quality future for our young people? How do we ensure that for our entire community? So today, this is a conversation that's helping us shape our graduating class of 2015, 2016, and our graduating class of 2027. This is us coming together tonight. This is us coming together as a community to have conversation of preparing our young people and preparing us. Because this is a theme for Edina this year. I am Edina Public Schools. We all have a role in this. We all have to come together. We have to be all for all. And we're honored to have Sharroky Hollie join us tonight. Sharroky is a Southern California boy. He is recognized nationally for his work around growing culturally responsive communities. He's been part of our school district community, a partner with us, helping our teaching staff and all of our staff and all of us grow in our skills of saying, how do we ensure all of us are working for all of our learners? He's a keynote speaker throughout the nation. He's an author, and he's an amazing person that brings people together to have great conversation. So today, this is our Grange Hall. This is our opportunity to come together and learn more about the Edina community of today and tomorrow. So with that, please welcome Sharroky Hollie.
Good evening, Edina. Good evening, Edina. How y'all doing? Come on, didn't he tell you I'm from LA? Y'all gotta pump it up now. How y'all doing? Y'all doing good? Welcome, welcome, welcome. I'm always humbled and honored to present our message and with you. So I want to thank the Edina schools and Rick and the leadership and all the great teachers and leaders for giving us this opportunity to share with you a little bit about culturally responsive and what it means to be a culturally responsive community, along with that matches in terms of what we're trying to do with the schools, which is make more culturally responsive classrooms. our time is really short, you know, and I'm really intending to get you out of here by midnight. So I'm just going to jump right into it, if that's okay. What I'm doing with you tonight is something that we kind of do a short version of a much longer professional development that we've done with the teachers of Edina. And I'm trying to give you a sample of that, and it's called 6 Ways to Know If You Are Culturally Responsive. What tonight is really about is me facilitating a reflective process with each of you in the room so that you can gauge for yourself on an individual level, to what extent am I culturally responsive? And then that individual level is going to expand out to represent the community, in essence, the community that we have here. See, I believe community is immunity, right? Say that after me. Community is immunity. What is it immunity from? It's from racism, right? It's from social injustice. It's from disproportionate treatment of those who are underserved. When we come together as a community, then what we're doing is we're holding ourselves immune from those things. So I want to sort of give you a sense of where are we with our community is immunity by running you through these 6 ways. And we're going to go really, really quick. And I want to forewarn you that it's interactive, okay? It's interactive, and you're going to be doing a lot of talk. I'm going to just treat you as if you're my students in my college class. Okay, that's what we're going to do as we run through it. I do want to tell you a little bit about what this journey is. I call it the journey to responsiveness, right? And this journey typically starts off with a conversation about race. We call it a courageous conversation about race. So that's really the first question you have to ask yourselves. Have I engaged in that conversation? Because that's what sort of opens the wound, if you will. And then after you have that conversation, the thing about it is, it's just the conversation to start. It's not the conversation to stop. It's supposed to begin, not be the end. And unfortunately, some people treat it as the end. But it's only supposed to begin the conversation. And then it should lead to issues of equity and discussions about social justice. And eventually, you're going to get to what I call responsiveness. See, responsiveness is a verb. I know it's said as a noun, but it's like a verb, right? Because this is where the action takes place. This is where the connection is made. This is where we respond to one another. And so I see it as the landing point. And this is where we sort of sit there. I call it planet responsiveness. And we just stay on that planet and we're exploring. You need to know where you are in your journey to responsiveness. And I'm hoping each of you, if I had the opportunity to talk to you individually, you could tell me where you were in your journey. And there would be no one out there saying, I didn't know there was supposed to be a journey, right? Because we're living in a day and age where the demographics are shifting fast, even here in your state, right? By the way, let me give you some kudos, not to get political, but it's just on my mind right now. Let me give some kudos to Minnesota for putting Donald Trump in his place, boy. That's what I'm talking about. You know, I was at home, and when I saw that come, I was like, yay, Minnesota! I just wanted to throw that out there right there real quick. Sorry, I hope no Trump fans are out there. I apologize. All right, okay, right. So this journey that I'm talking about then comes in 2 parts. It is a change in mindset. Now, this is what I want you to substitute right now. Substitute these words for mindset. My attitude, my disposition, my ignorance, my prejudice, my misunderstandings, my misconceptions, my insecurities, right? Substitute all those words for mindset. And if you're going to be on the journey, if you're going to be on the journey to responsiveness, you have to have a change in your mindset, your attitude, your disposition, your prejudice, your ignorance, right? And then there's a development of the skill set. Now, I work with educators, so I'm trying to develop their skill set, in particular around instructional practices and how they relate to students. That's my target audience. But it applies to anybody. If you're working in civil service, it applies to you. If you're working at Target, it applies to you, right? How can you develop in a way where you do your job better and you relate to others better? That's what the skill set is, right? And so when we talk about the journey of response, we've got to have a change in mindset and development of skill set. Now, For the parents, it's important to understand that we are specifically working with teachers around four areas, and I'll be real quick on this slide, but I just want the parents, the parents of the students to know that we're trying to help the teachers in areas of management, vocabulary, literacy, and language. I spent the whole day at Normandale. Any Normandale folks out there? Woo woo! Normandale's in the house. Woo! Right? Great day, wonderful day. It was fun for me because, of course, I don't know any French, right? Besides French fries, you know what I mean, right? Okay. I didn't have to pay attention to the content so much. I could just watch the kids. Right? I just watch the kids and see what they're doing. And by watching the students, it tells me what the teacher is doing. And that's fun. And I had a great day. And so we met with them afterwards and we talked about these things here. And this is what we're working with teachers to become more culturally responsive by how they teach the students and how they relate to the students. So it has a certain technicality to it. I want you to understand that. But it's important for parents. Yesterday, right before I came here, I was in California at our statewide Title I conference, and there was a parent contingency in my session. And a gentleman afterwards, and this is how you know, like, you're in the right place, you're doing the right thing. The gentleman came out, who's a Latino gentleman, he's the president of the PTA for his district, and he said, I just want to thank you because, you know, you hear about cultural responsiveness and you hear about cultural relevancy, I just never knew what it was. They would talk to me and I'd just smile, like, you know, we do that sometimes. He said, but you made it so crystal clear. I can go back and I can explain it to my parents and tell them, this is what you should be looking for when you go into the classrooms. This is what you should be looking for when you go into the schools. And that's what I want to do. I want to make it so plain and simple that anybody can walk in and say, yes, this is a culturally responsive school. Yes, this is a culturally responsive classroom. That's our goal. Now, many of you may be wondering, why are we doing this, right? It's a common question from anybody. Like, why is Edina having this night? You know, why, you know, I'm supposed to be getting ready for how to get away with murder right now, right? That's what, you messing up my Thursday night, right? Okay, right? Y'all don't watch How to Get Away with Murder? Okay, sorry, all right. I'll get the local reference in a moment. Somebody will shout it out, right? I try not to do the local reference because then they say I'm stereotyping, so I just try to stick to what I know from Hollywood, right? So that's where I'm from. So let's be clear on why we're doing this. I want you to be clear, right? Because I don't want you to see it as political. I don't want you to see it as this is a gamemanship. This is authentic, right? And I definitely don't want you to give this answer. We joke about the media a lot. You know, obviously the media plays a very important part. But I always envision the media asking maybe one of you, like if you're coming out, let's just say we go outside, it's like all this media. They're like, this black guy is speaking at Edina High School right now. Get over there quick, right? And it's not even February. Doo-doom doom. No, just kidding. Just kidding. Just kidding. Stay with me, all right? And they put the mic in your face. And they say, why? And then this is what I don't want you to say for the black kids. I don't want you to say for the Somali kids. I don't want you to say for that kid or those kids. This is the wrong answer to give because it turns people off. Why? They've heard it all before. It actually feeds into a fear that things are changing. See, it feeds into a fear because there are some people, as you know, I know they're not here tonight, but in your community who don't want things to change, right? And then when they have something like this going on that talks about culture and talks about responsiveness, and then the reaction is, oh, here we go. I knew it, right? Well, we have to debunk that. We have to fight that. And the best way that we fight that is by saying why we do responsiveness. So let me give you the three reasons to give to the media, right? Now let me give you some tricks for the media. You just have to speak in very short sentences, right? Because when you start doing long sentences, what the media does, it chops things up. And then that becomes what? The sound bite. And then you'll go on the paper, right? And then you'll see they are racist. But it didn't get the rest of your sentence all the way down the line, right? And you go, oh my gosh. So here's some short sentences. First reason is to increase student engagement. That's the first reason. We want the students of Edina to be better engaged in the teaching learning process. Because when they do that, they perform better. Particularly students who historically have not had success in a United States institution. This has nothing to do with Edina. Edina is a great district. We already know this. Edina is a high-performing district. We already know this, right? But we know that the United States school institution has historically failed certain populations. That's just the truth. That's just the reality. So we got to do, even a great Edina has to do whatever it can to ensure the success of all students. And the way we do that is by increasing student engagement. Okay, so that's number one, just three words. Okay, here's number two, to reduce disproportionality. Now I know disproportionality is a fancy term, too many syllables. So let's make it short. Deal with inequities. Let me ask you, do you know an inequity in Edina, right? Because Edina is great, but Edina is not perfect. There's no perfect district, there's no perfect school, there's no perfect community, right? They think they are, but they're not. So let me ask you, do you know the imperfections in your community, in your school? Because that, whatever you say, that will become the reason why we need cultural responsiveness. See, it's a very different answer than saying, oh, because of this people, that people. But if you say, these are unfairness that we're dealing with, these are imperfections that we're dealing with, these are inequities that we're dealing with, now you give a reason for it. But here's the problem. A lot of people, they don't want to articulate it, at least not publicly, right? And they don't have the courage, right? Like right now, I'm not going to do it with you because we don't have time, but usually the people in the audience who've seen this before, like, you know, Peter over here seen it me 500 times, right? He knows that right now I would ask one of you, right now, I would say, sir, do you know an inequity in Edina? Do you? Do you? Just say yes or no, just so I can go on. Yes, okay, all right, fine. I would just go around the room and I would ask because I want to know that you know, because if you know, then you're telling me you know the reason why you need cultural responsiveness. If people are walking around like, I don't know, why are we doing this? I'm not sure. You know, we have enough, right? Then what they're telling me is I don't have the reason for cultural responsiveness. So here's an assessment. Just say to yourself, do I know the inequities of my community? Do I know the imperfections of the school district? Just say it to yourself and then say, can I articulate it in an elevator pitch? And would I have the courage to say it? Or I'm not going to wait till I start walking out to the parking lot. See, some people looking at me right now like you would not say anything. You're going to be the main ones in the parking lot out there to 10 o'clock. You're ready to go soon at 8:30, and you're still out there at 10 o'clock talking about, watch, these are the ones we got to watch out for, right? I'm saying council meetings, are you willing to say it? School board meetings, are you willing to say it? School site council meetings, are you willing to say it? Here's a stereotype. I'm honest with mine. I have a stereotype that communities like yours hide behind emails. And I just envision one of you sitting there just sending a long email. Right? Rather than just going down to the meeting and just saying it. See? This is called voice. This is called advocacy. This is why, but see, it gets twisted. I'm going to go on a tangent right now, so I'm going to stop. I'm going to stop because I was going to go on a tangent. All right, so second reason, reduce inequities, okay? Here's the third reason. I call it the more love reason. More love reason. I want you to say to yourselves right now, who in our community needs more love? Who in our schools needs more love? Just say that to yourselves, right? I call this love outrageous love. Who needs outrageous love? Outrageous love is beyond ordinary love. There are some in the community who need outrageous love. And the question is, are we as a community capable and willing to give it? In my hometown of LA, I know where the outrageous love is needed. But there are some places where people aren't capable and they're not willing to give it. And I'm asking you, where is the outrageous love needed? And then I'm going to ask you, are you capable and willing to give it, right? This has nothing to do with ordinary love. I know you love your community. I know you love your schools. This is not the issue. So before some of you get what I call offensive, right? Okay? I want you to just say to yourself, I know he's not questioning my love. What he's asking is, do I have more love? That's what I'm asking, right? And I need to know before I go on, before we get to the nitty-gritty here, I need to know that you are capable and willing, because we're going to be talking about cultural responsiveness. I want to know if you're capable or willing, right? Okay? All right? So I need to know that you are basically a happy person. That's what I need to know. So I'm going to run you through some quick assessments, and you can tell me if you're happy or not. These are very quick, all right? We don't have to, like, look at IDs or anything, okay? All right? All right? So here's assessment number one. I want you to tell your faces that you're happy. Tell your faces that you're happy. Just do that right now. Tell your face that you're happy. Do that for me right now. Tell your face. There you go. He's trying really hard. All right, there you go. Okay, good, good. All right, awesome, awesome, awesome. Okay, all right. All right, here's assessment number two. I just want you, just real quickly, I just want you to tell yourself that you're awesome. Just tell yourself that, on my go, you're going to say, I am awesome, right? Just on my go, just say, I am awesome. Say it like you're from L.A., right? Just say it like you're L.A. Just say, I am awesome. And you kind of look at your neighbor like, you better recognize, I am awesome, okay? On three. One, two, three.
I am awesome.
All right. All right. Assessment number three. Now, I want you to turn to your neighbor, and I want you to tell your neighbor what's so awesome about you. You just claim to be awesome. Now, I want you to turn to your neighbor. I want you to say, this is what's awesome about me. You need to know that, because you don't have the posture of the person who should be sitting next to me right now. Just say one thing, one characteristic, one attribute, something that makes you awesome. Just something, just real quick. Go, turn to your neighbor. All right, when I say bring it, you say back, bring it, bring it, bring it. Good, you seem happy, this is good. All right, let's do the last assessment. The last assessment is simply to show love to someone else, just to show love to someone else. And what I want to ask you to do in a moment is, I want you to do what's called pan and move. Pan and move. Now, we can't move too much, but all I want you to do is move to someone that you did not come with tonight. That's really so. No. So if you have to move just two down, that's fine. If you go behind you, that's fine. I just don't want you to do the activity with the person that you came with tonight. The first part of the activity, you are to pan the room. That means you're going to look around the room, and we're going to admire all the genius, the brilliance, the beauty, the intelligence, the dedication. I want you to have a facial expression of admiration. Just show me your facial expression of admiration right now. Give me a facial expression of admiration. There you go. That's good. That's very good, right? Right? Give me a facial expression of admiration. Okay, that's good. Is that? Well, that's kind of like I just won the lottery. I don't know, right? Right, okay, right? So you're gonna hold that for 10 seconds. I'm gonna count down. I need you to pan the room. Look at your community. Look at your community and admire your community. And I'm gonna count down 8, 7, 6, 5. And then when I get to 0, not yet. I'm gonna say move. And I want you to move to someone that you didn't come with this evening. And I want you to go to that person. I want you to reach out to them physically with a handshake, a high five, a pound, whatever. Just reach out to them. And then I want you to say something like this. Say something like this. I am honored to be in this room with you. Right? You make me a better person just by being here. Right? It's a joy to have this experience with you. I want you to hallmark it, okay? Sap it up, all right? Just lay it on them, right? Make them just like they're so sweet, you want to lick them. You know what I'm saying? Okay? All right. So here we go. Let's pan. 10, 9, 8, 7, six, five, four, three, two, one. Now move. Find somebody to sap it up with. All right, let's return to our seats. Let's return to our seats. You see, that energy right there, that's the energy of community, folks. That's love right there. That's more love. I want this to be an affirmatorium, where we're just affirming each other over and over and over. We're encouraging each other. We're inspiring each other. That's community, right? So you've passed the test. You seem like happy people, all right? Okay? All right? So now we can kind of get to the topic at hand, but I'm going to give you an anticipation guide first, and all you got to do is shout out true or false. This is easy. You got a 50-50 chance here. Just shout out true or false. I'm going to put up four statements, and you just tell me if they're true or false. Diversity, equity, and cultural responsiveness are interchangeable concepts. True or false? My racial identity dictates my cultural identity. True or false? Cultural responsiveness is only for minority students. True or false? All right, those of you struggling, go back to your test-taking strategies. One more left. The goal for culturally responsive teaching, the goals for culturally responsive teaching are best met at the district level. You got them all right, right? These are all misnomers about culturally responsiveness. They're myths, and we got to straighten them out, right? First of all, this is not about diversity. This is not about equity. Those are two separate things, right? And they need to be treated differently. There needs to be a conversation about diversity. There needs to be a conversation about equity. And then there's cultural responsiveness. I do not see them as interchangeable. A lot of institutions, though, use them interchangeably. They see them one and the same, but they are different. Secondly, this race culture thing, we got to straighten out because our focus is on culture. So why is it that we think about race when we think about culture? And I'm going to come back to this a little later to see if you've bought into that unknowingly, right? Thirdly, this is not just for the minority kids. This is not just for kids of color. Anybody who says that has it wrong. You tell them you are a twister. Say that's a twist, right? Now, if you're in LA, we would say you a liar. But y'all don't do that here in Minnesota nice. I'll figure that out, okay? It's not the way things go here. So I have to give you some code terms to fit into Minnesota nice, right? So you tell them that's twisting, right? It's not just for the minority students. It's for all students. It's for all students. In particular, the students who are not having success. Right? Can I tell you something? I'm telling on Normandale right here. I don't think they mind. But, and I hope some of y'all get this. This is the irony of my work. I've been in hundreds of schools. Thousands of classrooms. Typically, when I'm working in a school, if I go to the office and there are youngsters in trouble, they are African-American boys. Overwhelmingly, right? I mean, it's a picture in the office, right? I walk in the office and I see the little guy sitting there. In fact, sometimes I do this, and he goes. When I go in classrooms, you know, the classrooms, they have these timeout sections, right? Take a break. You know, some of us who've been around, this is, you know, I used to tell you, go outside the door. Remember those from that generation? But now they tell the kids, you know, it's a take a break. And some of these classrooms, they've made them into like with little cushy areas and magazines, like a little waiting room kind of thing, right? And when I go in those classrooms, who do I see in the take a break section? African-American boys, Latino boys, right? I mean, I'm saying 99% of the time, every once in a while, I may see a girl. Every once in a while. But today at Normandale, I saw I saw a white boy and take a break. And I said, my, I have made it to the promised land. Right? I could not believe it, because I rarely see that, right? But this is significant because it shows that we have some underserved children here in Edina. They may not fit the stereotype, or they may not fit the mold, but if I'm going into all the classrooms and I'm seeing boys, right, then I know boys need to be better served. This proves right there that this approach is for everyone. All we have to do is figure out is who is in need of it. That's all. That's how it works. And lastly, this is best done at the school level, at the classroom level, or at the grassroots level of the community, and then go up from there. That's how this is best done. It does not work the best when it's district mandated, right? You're in a great situation. You have district support, district vision, district leadership, but it's going to be on the street that makes this happen. For us in the schools, the street is the classroom. For the community, it's going to be through organizations that deal with issues of equity and social justice, right? You're going to have to make that happen. We need that voice there. We cannot wait on high, because the institution has given us zero evidence that it can be supportive for students who need it the most, for community members. Who would you depend on to say we can bring change for those who need it the most? We have to take it to the people, and that's what this approach is about. Okay? All right. So here we go. Here are the six ways. We're going to go through them fairly quickly here. So I'm gonna have you just, and remember, it's your own assessment. How culturally responsive am I? Here's way number one. You can define it. So this is what I want you to do. I want you to tell your elbow partner, what is your definition of cultural responsiveness? How do you define it, right? If this is the first time you're hearing it, just give a guess. Give an intellectual guess. What does it mean to be culturally responsive? Share with your neighbor. I'll call you back in about 2 minutes. Go. All right, when I say peace, you say quiet. Peace.
Quiet.
Peace.
Quiet.
So this is the issue right here. The issue is, do we have common terminology, common concepts? Now, ordinarily, I would go through the terms of diversity. I would go through the terms of equity. But just as you were listening to your neighbors, the question is, are we speaking the same language? And if you're not, you're going to get what's called stagnation. And what stagnation is, you kind of keep doing the same thing, but you're not getting anywhere. You keep having the same topics in the meeting. You keep going over the same things, but you're not getting anywhere. And part of that is because we're not speaking a common language. So what I encourage you to do, Edina, is make sure you have a common language around these terms, right? Now, fortunately, there is a research base, and I just want to share one particular researcher that I like is Geneva Gay, right? She sort of gives us a good definition for it. I'm not really into definitions per se, but I do like the last sentence of her definition. And it says, culturally responsiveness is culturally validating and affirming. And it is from those two words that I've built my way of looking at it that I want you to remember. And that is to validate, affirm, build, and bridge. Validate, affirm, build, and bridge. And it is affectionately known as vabbing. Vabbing. And I simply want Edina to be vabulous. Right? Real quickly, validate and affirm means to make legitimate and positive that which institutional knowledge and mainstream media has made illegitimate and negative about underserved cultural and linguistic behaviors. The institution tells them your behavior is bad. The culture responsiveness says, no, it has value, and we're going to validate it and affirm it. And when it comes to images, we have to affirm it, because if you look at the media, you see that the images are portrayed negatively, misperceived, misconceptions. And so what we have to do, we have to counter that in the media. Right? That's the validation affirmation part. What's the building bridge part? To give the students the academic skill set that they'll need to navigate mainstream culture or academic culture. through a process that we call situational appropriateness. What does that mean? We teach students to be situationally appropriate depending on the culture and language that's needed at the time, right? See, these students I saw today, if they go anywhere where they need to code switch into French, they're gonna have the skill set to do that because they're learning French. That's what I mean, that's situational appropriateness. Situational appropriateness is I'm going for a job interview, right? And I know how to walk in, I know the walk to walk in the building. That represents the culture of the job I'm going to. I know to do the mainstream handshake, right? I know to look them in the eye. I know when I sit down, I got to speak pristine standard English. That's called situational appropriateness. Now, that doesn't mean I give up who I am. Don't get it twisted, right? Because when I walk out of the interview, as soon as I'm out the building, I'm like this, you know, right? I'm doing my thing, right? Okay? Right? I'm doing a different handshake. I'm looking who I'm talking to in a different way. I'm speaking my home language. That's what we mean by situational appropriateness. And that's the build and bridge part. We teach students what do they need to have success in different places. Are you with me? Tell your faces that you're with me, because some of y'all looking the same since 7 o'clock. You ain't changed your face one time. It's like these row of gentlemen, they just all look the same, like we're going to play poker or something. I don't know. Okay? All right? So remember, validate, affirm, build, and bridge. You could get confused because there are a lot of people out there selling cultural responsiveness. So be careful because they call it all kind of things, competency, proficiency, compatibility, relevancy. So just know what you're looking at. Know what you're reading because it is a buzzword. And in education, when something becomes a buzzword, right, it's the end of that word basically, right? So I believe that we have to have our language straight so that we can have our thoughts straight. All right, where are you? Yeah, yes. Exactly.
Is that better? Can you hear me now? So my question was, if the approach is saying that we need to give kids the ability to adapt themselves to match the culturally appropriateness of a situation, are we not then saying that having only one culturally appropriate way is okay? And should we not be trying to change some of the cultural situations so that people don't need to change who they are?
Well, we're not saying that there's any one preferred cultural way. We're not saying that.
But why should you, with your swagger and different dialect, not be able to get that same job with your proficient, beautiful English?
Well, because what we're saying is that cultural norms are of value regardless of where you are. So if you came to work for my organization, you would see that there's a subscription to Black culture, right? I would expect you, when you're among in the organization, that you would be able to relate to the customers, that you would be able to speak to your colleagues, that you would be able to follow the norms of the organization. I don't see that as a bad or negative thing. What's been bad or negative is when I tell you that you have to permanently change yourself, right? Or that what you're bringing is negative, or that what you're bringing doesn't have any value. This is the opposite of that. But it recognizes that there is a cultural norm no matter where we go around the world. I've traveled around the world and I've had to code switch as a United States citizen. I traveled in Africa, right? Should I tell the Ghanaians, I want to be United States citizens up in here, right? No, you know what they tell me? Sit down, right? You are in Ghana here, right? You're going to be waiting a long time, right? Because I'm in my United States culture, I want it right now. No, that's not how it is done here. I want my beer cold. No, we don't have cold beer. And if you suggest putting ice, they go, ew, right? So I think what's underneath your question, if I could just go there because I've heard it many times, is that the imposition on someone, we agree with you on that. No one's culture should be imposed on someone else, right? But that's not what I'm describing here, right? If I make a choice to go to USC, where I'm from, right, where I went to USC, to get my doctorate degree, there is an expectation that I will follow the norms of the USC PhD student, period. And that's what we need to teach our students, that they can have that skill set so they can have success at USC, if they choose to. There are a lot of people who don't choose to, okay? All right, let's go to number two. Being culturally responsive is something that you are, not that you do. This requires a one-word answer to your neighbor. All you gotta do is just say one word, and that's the answer to this question. Are culturally responsive educators or anybody, are they born or are they made? It's only two choices. Just turn to your neighbor, born or made, go. Okay, let me give the answer, both. It was a trick question. In this audience right now, the research tells me out of University of Texas, San Antonio, two Latina professors who studied people who have attended culturally responsive trainings, surveyed them, they've concluded that 10% of you came in this room culturally responsive because that's who you are. You're culturally responsive with your family, you're culturally responsive with your neighbor, you're culturally responsive on your job, that's just who you are. You're just a natural, right? 80% of you in the room, you're going to have to be made. Meaning this one little session is not going to do it. You need to read some books. You need to watch some YouTube. You need some feedback. You need some practice before you become culturally responsive. The problem is that our institution treats people like this. Go to a culturally responsive training and then come back culturally responsive. Right? You know how your job sends you on a training, they want you to learn a new technique, a new device. Now, when you come back from that training, you better know that new technique. You better know that new device. But see, culturally responsiveness doesn't work that way. It's all about an evolution. I would expect no one here to leave tonight and you walked in not culturally responsive to walk out culturally responsive. Right? I wouldn't expect any of you to go out like, yeah, I'm bad. I'm culturally responsive right now. Yep. Right? In fact, if I see you walking in the parking lot like that, I'm going to take the keys before you get in the car, okay? And then there are 8 to 9% of you, I don't care if they were passing out $1 million tonight, you would still not be culturally responsive because you're looking through a deficit lens only, right? You're looking at it from a standpoint of what I call race-based, right? There would be a lot to move you, a lot to change you. So the point I want to make with you is most people have to be made culturally responsive. And the institution has not done a good job of supporting making people, right? Because we want to just send them to a quick training. We want them just to read one book and then expect to change. It doesn't work that way. All right, let's go to way number three. You are not confused about your identity. Now, this is the most provocative one because it gets at, do you know who you are so that you can be empathetic with others? Because another word for cultural responsiveness is empathy, right? I gave you more love. That's one. I gave you vab. Here's another way of looking at it, empathy. When you empathize with someone, you can be cultural. Let's get it straight though, not sympathy. Sympathy is not culturally responsive, and that's one of the issues. We got a lot of people feeling sorry for our students. And so when you feel sorry for someone, then you lower your expectation. But empathy is high expectation. So we don't need any sympathy, but we need your empathy. And how do I know how to get empathy? Well, I need to know that you know who you are. So I'm going to do a little activity with you that I do with educators, right? So you could tell me who you are. You're going to fill in the blanks mentally right now. And the first blank you're going to fill in is you're going to tell me your racial identity. Then you're going to tell me a behavior that goes with your race. Then I want to know your citizenship. And then you're going to give me a behavior that goes with your citizenship. You only do this behavior because of where you're located on the Google map. That's it. If you were located somewhere else in the world, you would be doing a different behavior. Then you're going to give me your ethnic identity. Now, this is the one that's probably going to confuse a lot of you. So let's make it clear. Ethnic identity is your home culture. It's your home culture, right? Think about where you were raised, who raised you. Think about your heritage. Think about your family reunions. That's ethnic identity. And then give me a behavior that you do that is connected to your home culture. So it is six blanks. You cannot use the word human. That's cheating. All right? Try not to write the same word twice, or not. Try not to say the same word twice. I'm going to give you 1 minute to think this through. And then you're going to share your identity with somebody else in the room. Okay? So I'm going to give you 1 minute, just 1 minute to think it through. Okay, as you think it through, I want to let you know why we're doing this. Because this is where people get kind of what I call offensive in the sessions right now, right? We're doing this to make it clear the difference between race and culture. Because if you listen to the media, if you read books in our society, we have conflated them. Number two, we're doing this so we can understand the definition of culture and its complexity. Number three, I need to know that you know who you are, because if you have confidence in who you are, then you're more likely to have empathy. Part of the confusion in our society is we're not comfortable with who we are. So it creates fear, right? Or it creates this, we're all human. Right, you ever hear somebody say that on the job, at the gas station? In the classroom, like I love these students, you know, when the teacher is in the beginning of the year and the teacher tells them, you don't have to worry, boys and girls. We're all human. And even a second grader will go like, whoa, it's going to be a long year if you just thought you just told us something. That's the best you coming with already? Woo, right? In other words, you ain't saying nothing by saying we're human. By the mere fact I didn't come here with wings and a beak, that lets you know right there that I'm human. But sometimes people, they want to say things like, I treat all people the same. You ever hear somebody say that? It's impossible. Even parents don't treat their kids the same. It's humanly impossible. And any of you who think that you're doing that, you're fooling yourselves. Then you have some people who say, well, I don't see any difference in anyone. Right? I don't see any difference. It's another form of saying we're all human, right? But they say, I don't see any difference. I have a nose, you have a nose. I have lips, you have, you know, you ever hear people say this? Right? Right? I used to say the whole I have hair, you have hair thing, but then as I look around the room, I had to stop saying that. You ever have that experience there? Right? Just kidding. Right. So they'll go, I'll never sit in the front again if Sharroky Hollie's here. The problem with this, is Martin Luther King taught us this. He said, I'd rather you talk negatively about me than ignore my difference. Isn't that brilliant? Right? I'd rather you say something negative than just tell me we're all the same. And once again, I love our kids. See, the kids tell the truth. That's why I love kids. They tell the truth, right? Imagine saying to the kids, you're just my second graders. You're just my chemistry students. And some of these students, they understand, they're like, wait a minute, that's all I am to you as a second grader? Don't you see all this right here? You better recognize I'm more than a second grader. So people who are so uncomfortable doing this that it shuts them down, it leads you down that road. So let's see, you're gonna share by doing what I call silent appointments. That means you're gonna have to look two rows beyond you, either frontwards or backwards, and find somebody to go share your identity with. Okay? And now you can't talk. We're gonna use nonverbals, eye contact, hand gestures, facial expression, and body language, and you're gonna find somebody in the room to go talk. And I really want you to try to stretch two rows beyond. Right? Now, once you know you have a confirmation that you have an appointment, I want you to do this. This will just let people in the room know I have an appointment. Okay? We're not moving. We're not talking. Let's make our appointments silently. Just find somebody. Don't move yet, though. Don't move. Just make your appointment. Don't move. Just make your appointment. Let me give you a hint. You got to look at somebody. Okay, I think we got everybody pretty much. That's close enough, if you will. All right, now I'm gonna give you one more instruction. So sit down, I'm gonna give you one more instruction, then we can go. Now, whenever we move in culture-responsive classrooms, we encourage cultural greetings. Cultural greetings, right? Because cultural greetings are very important. You know, in a lot of cultures, they really signal the first respect, the first honor, right? The first, if you will, human connection. In some cultures, if you don't get the greeting right, you can't even do business, right? Because you've disrespected them already. So I like to infuse cultural greetings whenever we move. I'm going to do one with you that I learned recently in Albuquerque, New Mexico. I was speaking to a staff in Las Lunas. There was a Filipino teacher. She was the only Filipino teacher on staff. I did the activity that I'm doing with you, and she went around and she taught. Her colleagues this greeting. It's called mano. And what you're going to do is you're going to start off what appears to be like a mainstream handshake. But then what you're supposed to do, you're supposed to turn the hand, right? So let's say you're shaking my hand, right? And you would turn my hand and then bring it up to your forehead as a way of showing respect to your elder, right? Or showing honor to your elder, right? Got that? So you're going to start off with a mainstream handshake, and then I'll let you figure out who should be showing the respect. Turn it this way or turn it that way. Now I know in the public, I'm not saying you got to, like, you know, touch people's forehead and do all this because, you know, okay, don't start breaking out with the hand sanitizer and all that kind of stuff, okay? Just kind of simulate it, right? And that is a Filipino, it's called mano. That's a Filipino greeting. The interesting thing about this, the principal came up and said, He didn't even know she was Filipino in terms of her cultural background. I mean, he knew she was Filipino, but he didn't know that she practiced her culture. That was the first time she had shared anything about her culture in 2 years of working with the staff. That's the power of culture responsiveness right there. Okay? All right? Now, one more rule. When you get with the person and you greet one another, just read the blanks. Do not start telling your life story. We're trying to get out of here by 8:30, okay? Go. All right. Now, as I said before, this is one of the most provocative aspects of our work. It really challenges folks to get into what's known as identity development, right? So we have to be honest here. See, the people who've had the courageous conversations, this is not going to be so much an issue for them, but the people who have not, it's going to be a bit of a struggle, right? So I'm going to ask you a question to test your honesty. I need to know you're a happy crowd, and I need to know if you're an honest crowd, okay? Keeping in mind that the person that you just talked to does not know where you parked or where you live. I want you to raise your hand if you just talked to a person who sounded confused about race and culture. Raise your hand. Come on, they don't know where you live. You can raise your hand. They ain't gonna meet you in the parking lot, okay? Because another name for this activity is how confused are we about race? This is what keeps us stagnated as a country. Because whenever we bring up race, we conflate it with culture. Whenever we bring up culture, we conflate it with race, right? And if we would just keep them separate, things would be crystal clear. It would be crystal clear. But we mix up the two. We mix up the two. And I wanna try to clarify for you. So I'm going to give you the answers to who you are. I'd be a little more excited if I was you about that, right? I was about to find, there you go, yeah, there you go, right? Okay, right? Now, we cannot go deep. So don't come at me like that. I got to give you the quick answers. It's the Reader Digest version here, right? So don't try to go deep when we get to the question and answer center. You start quoting studies and stuff. You didn't sign up for the full seminar, okay? So don't go seminar on me, all right? Because I'm just going to fill in the blanks for you right now. And I'm going to give you a little research behind each one just to let you know that I'm not making it up. So let's go. Racial identity. Here's my answer. It should not be a color. There should not be a color in a blank because race is not color. If you don't believe me, go to National Geographic Human Genome Project. And they will teach you that race is the story of human geography. And what should go in that blank is a geographical location based on where people who look like you started many, 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 many years ago. I have personal proof because I've never been in this train. I've been doing this for 16 years. I've never had an Asian write yellow. I had a Middle Eastern gentleman a couple of weeks ago. He was joking. He said, what do you want me to put in here, wheat? So ask yourselves, why did I write black? Why did I write white? And I would say that you've brought in to the institutional knowledge that has taught us that race is color. Let's go to the other side. The behavior that goes with your race. Let me give you the answer. Blank. It should have been left blank because there is no behavior that goes with your race. It was a trick question. Let me say it again. There is no behavior that goes with your race. It's a trick question. It's anthropologically impossible to attach race to behavior. In fact, when we do that, we have a name for it. What do we call it? Stereotyping. Racist. Let me give you another term. Racialization. Racialization. When we attach behavior to race, it's called racializing. We're going to have a question. If you can't hold it, I'll take it. But we're going to have one, right? Right? So what I'm saying is to attach race to behavior, it's a false notion, right? Race is about genetic lineage. It's about phenotypes. In essence, race is socially constructed, which is a fancy term for it's all made up. But so is Santa Claus. I hope I didn't break anybody's heart right now, right? I was just kidding, kids. Oh, she has on an earphone, so she doesn't know. She's like, good, right? Okay? So what I'm saying is race is not culture. That's why we call it culturally responsive teaching, not racially responsive teaching. That's why I'm saying if you look at somebody, you look at their external, and then you link behavior to it, This is being racist. This is thinking racist, right? It's also known it comes out in unconscious biases as well. Your unconscious bias. This is that initial first thought. Are you with me? Give me a facial expression that you're with me. Just do, there you go. Wink, blink, give me the finger, whatever. Just do something, okay? Right? Now, let's be clear about it. What I'm saying is, if this young lady is looking at me right now, and she's saying, in her mind, she's saying, I bet you he can dance. That's racialization right there, because I can't dance, okay, right? And if I look at her and I say, I bet you can't dance, and she said, I can dance right now, right? See, but notice how we do that all the time, just walking up and down the street, how quickly we do this. Let's go to national identity. It's simply just saying, this is where I was born, this is where I was raised, and these are the behaviors that I learned simply based on geographical location. There is no other influence, right? Okay, and then there are behaviors that go with that. If you were born somewhere else, you'll be doing different behaviors. It's that simple. It's that simple. When I first started coming here 3 years ago, I remember I thought that the crowd, we did this activity, I was in St. Louis Park, and they mentioned s'mores. And I thought they were kidding. And I was like, s'mores are real? That's just not like a Hershey thing? They were like, they got offended. Are you? No, that's our, you better recognize, right? Well, that's geographical, right? If you ask anybody in LA about s'mores, they'll start laughing at you. See, that's, so what I'm saying is just by your location, you can change your behavior. Well, we have a lot of students that are coming into the schools. We have a lot of people who are coming into your community that are coming with different national cultures. And the question that you're going to have to answer is, how do we validate and affirm the people coming from the different countries, right? Or are we going to do what the lady suggested earlier, force them into our culture? No, we got to learn about them so that we can respect and value, validate and affirm, and at the same time, show them the Edina way. It's that simple. Now, let's go to ethnic identity. Ethnic identity, I define as your home culture. And all you got to just think about who raised you, where you were raised, family and heritage. That is your ethnic identity. Guess what, folks? This is where the color goes. Right there. Some of you are confused because you've taken white to be a color when actually it is an ethnic identity that is connected to white Anglo-Saxon that became known as whiteness. But it is a cultural identity. It is not a racial identity because I have people here in the audience who are Caucasian, but they are not WAS. They're Italian, they're Polish. I had a lady yesterday, she said, was I supposed to write white in there? I said, no, you weren't supposed to. She said, because I'm Italian. And I said, okay, write Italian. She said, I just wanted to be clear about that. And I said, that's exactly where I'm going with this. That's your ethnic identity. So, in case you haven't figured out by now, I subscribe to blackness. Right? I am of African ancestry. That's my race, geographical location. I am a United States citizen, and my ethnic identity is blackness. I subscribe to black culture. Now, some of you say, well, what does that mean? Well, that's when we go to the behavior side. This is when anthropologists have taught us, and they've taught us very well. See, my ethnic behaviors, they come in two levels. There's a superficial level, and there's a deep level that I've learned from home. Right? Superficial, food, dress, hair, music, those are all superficial. That's representative of home culture. Just think about your home culture foods. Think about food that you used to eat with grandma and grandpa and family reunions. Just think about it right now. That's superficial. Think about clothes, as a kid growing up, how you were dressed. Think about customs, holidays, how you did family celebrations. That's superficial. Deep is intangible, so you can't see it. Deep has to do with proximity. Deep has to do with eye contact. Deep has to do with pitch of voice. Deep has to do with time. Let's use that as an example. Your concept of time is culturally based. See, this is why I said we got to go to anthropology research. So I told you I subscribe to black culture, right? So time is defined in two ways, preciseness or relativity. That's how time is described. Some cultures follow a precise time concept. What does that mean? The clock controls the action. Are you with me? We are supposed to end at 8:30. Those of you who are on a precise time cultural base, you're going to be getting ready to go at 8:30. You have to be to work tomorrow at what time, sir? 7 o'clock. Let them come in at 7:20 and see what happened. School is going to start at a certain time. These are all precise. Our culture mainly is run by precise time, right? It's so precise that the airlines, my flight tomorrow leaves at 5:36. Isn't that ridiculous? They can't even round it up or down. And what they're saying to me is, we're not leaving till 5:36, right? This is Delta, by the way. That means that all the luggage can be loaded. We could be ready to go. And the pilot will come on and say, we're all ready to push back. We're ready to get out of here. But our pushback time is not to 5:36. So just hold tight. Blah, 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 blah. This is why I like Southwest. Because they follow a relative time frame. Right? What does relative mean? Relative means that you are ruled by what's going on at the time. You're not ruled by the clock. See, I subscribe to black culture. Black culture is relative with time. See, but the media has taught us stereotypically that black folks do what? Always running late. Are you following me? That's what the media has taught. That's the stereotype. Some of y'all are sitting here and deny it. This is the Minnesota nice thing. I get what you're saying, right? Right? But that's the stereotype. But it has nothing to do with that. It is like many other cultures around the world, time is relative. I am controlled by what's going on with the human interaction. So that means that if we were following a black cultural dynamic in here, I wouldn't be keep looking at the clock to see if it's 8:30 yet. I would just finish when I finish, and you would hang with me. If I went to 10 o'clock, you would stay with me culturally. And some of you should see your faces right now. You say, you must be out of your damn mind. So my point is that you have students who are coming with their home cultures. Some of them are obvious in how they dress. That's called surface. You can look at how a student's dress walking down the hallway, and we can tell the cultural dynamic there. But there are things underneath. This is where the heart of cultural responsiveness is. And in order to be culturally responsive, we have to look underneath for those intangible behaviors. Because that's what we want validated and affirmed. That's what we want validated and affirmed. All these are behaviors, I call them the rings of culture. And I want you to know, whenever people talk about cultural responsiveness and they put my name with it, this is what I'm talking about right here. And I want you to know that race is not a ring. Now be clear, I'm not saying we're gonna ignore race. Race is omnipresent in the United States. Right? You cannot get around it, right? So don't just save your question on that. We have to deal with racism, 100%. All I'm saying is let's not confuse it with cultural responsiveness. And when we want to be responsive to our community members, we want to be responsive to our students, this is what I'm talking about. Age culture, gender culture, religious culture, orientation culture. This is what we're asking educators to do. To validate and affirm students as they come. And we want you as community members to validate and affirm each other as well, right? Along these lines. Certainly, ethnic culture is an important one, but it's not the only one. And our society trains us to just focus on ethnic cultural identity. Did you know, just so you'll know, in schools, the number one predominant cultural behavior is age. Kids are behaving accordingly based on their age, not any other ring. Right? So I'll have students do certain behaviors and the teacher will look at me and she'll say, is he doing that because he's black? And I'll say, no, he's doing it because he's eight. And that's what eight-year-olds do. So let's be culturally responsive to youth culture. Right? All right. Let's go to way number four. Based on what I've described thus far. Now, this is the hard question for you. I want you to tell your neighbor, who are the underserved in Edina? Who do you think, based on your knowledge, based on your perspective, will benefit most from the approach I'm describing to you tonight? Just based on your own knowledge, just based on wherever you're coming from, whatever walk of life, whatever job, just say to yourself, wow, this culturally responsive, who do you think of if you think, wow, if we could validate and affirm them, that would be great. Share with your neighbor, who might that be? I'm going to call you back in like 1 minute. Go. All right, I'm going to say hip, hip. You say hooray. Hip, hip.
Hooray.
Hip, hip.
Hooray.
Hip, hip.
Hooray.
This is an important question because you need to know who we have to be culturally responsive to, right? I think it's worth a conversation. This is when we look at the data. We look at statistics. But there's no mystery in our country, who are the underserved populations? These are the top five underserved populations, regardless of wherever I go, from San Diego to Asbury Park, New Jersey, from Tampa, Florida, to Seattle, Washington. These are the underserved. It's no mystery. You're not introducing us to sliced bread to say that these students aren't performing well. Notice that Native Americans are the number one, but their populations are small, so they don't get the attention that they really deserve, except for in New Mexico. You know, and I want you to notice at the bottom that we don't use code terms like Latino and Asian. If you're going to know your community members, then know who they are. They're not Asians. There are a lot of different Asian communities. From a California perspective, we know who the Koreans are. We know who the Japanese are. We know who the Chinese are. We don't refer to everyone as Asian. So your neighbor, your coworker, know who they are. Don't talk in code. The same thing goes with the term Latino. There are a lot of Latino cultures, and they are very, very different. If you don't believe me, try calling a Mexican El Salvadorian and see what happens. Okay? You're gonna start a fight, right? Because they're different culturally. So we know among Latinos that Mexican Americans are the most underserved. We know that among Asians, Hmong students are the most underserved, right? And you also have continent African populations here that we could throw on the list specific to this part of the country, where we know that the Somali student is the most underserved, right? So what I'm saying to you is, if you have these demographics coming into your community, then you know you're gonna have to address it, because we've had institutional failure as it applies. All right, let's do number five. Yes or no, tell your neighbor, did you celebrate Black History Month? Just tell your neighbor, yes or no. Tell the truth, yes or no. Go look at me, look at your neighbor. Did you celebrate Black History Month, yes or no? See, some of y'all ain't being honest, right? Number five, you don't celebrate Black History Month. So some of y'all going like, whoo, good. I thought he was gonna say I had to celebrate. No, I wanna stick a word in there though. You just don't celebrate Black History Month if you're culturally responsive. You celebrate culture all the time. You don't wait on a month. You don't wait on a dead figure, right? Because that's not what this is about. So be clear. Some of you thinking, oh, that means they're going to be putting more dead people on the walls at the schools. No, it does not. That means they're going to have more monthly celebrations. No, it does not. That means they're going to have more Black guest speakers. No, it's not. Right? I heard you coming over here, right? Right? No, no. This is what I call the superficial approach to culture responsiveness. Ethnic food day, ethnic dress day, right? They do this in the city as well, right? Wait till Cinco de Mayo comes. You'll see what I mean, right? Mariachi band, right? Free margaritas, right? Viva Mexico. This is the wrong way to celebrate culture. So I put this and I say it, you just don't celebrate. You don't do superficial. But since we are talking about Black History Month, and I know it's March, but we only have a couple of days out. I got another week or so to go, okay? All right? It's relative. I want you to give you a little tidbit here. Carter G. Woodson is the creator of what was known as Negro History Week, right? He did not intend for it to go to a month, and he did not intend for it to last for 100 years. He had a dream, he had a vision that the schools would adopt the contributions of African Americans into the history curriculum, and it would be woven into the books. And therefore, you would not need a Negro History Week. I guarantee you he's turning over in his grave. So when we just single out months, when we just single out weeks, when we just focus on dead figures, this is not how we do cultural responsiveness. So ask yourselves, how do I celebrate culture every day? And when you do that, you don't need to celebrate Black History Month. See, I ran a school for 10 years for African American students in Los Angeles, and we celebrated culture every single day. So when February came, we didn't have a need to separate it out, because every month was February. And you're gonna need to do the same thing here. With all the different cultures, with all the different peoples, how can we infuse this from day one to the last day? That's the way this needs to be looked at. Last thing, practice every day in every way. And all this simply means is that we're gonna bring this back to where we started. Our main way of approaching this, folks, is through instructional practices. But we wanted you to be aware of what we're trying to accomplish, because we think that what we're doing feeds into the community. And when the community understands, then we get the support and it becomes reciprocal. What I'm saying is we have a better Edina community, one that is culture responsive. We really work with teachers on their pedagogy. So our focus is on the why and the how, not so much as on the what. So you don't have to worry about me recommending that Edina adopts Malefe Asante's history textbook. You don't have to worry about that, right? Right? I'm going to be working on that teachers validate and affirm all students in a way that helps them be better students, just like those little boys I saw in the timeout today. Okay? And I want to leave you with this so that you'll see what we're trying to accomplish in the classroom specifically. There are specific things that we look for, and I'm really talking to our parents, so then you can go in and you can say, is your classroom culturally responsive? Is your school being culturally responsive? And none of these are cultural centric, meaning these speak to any culture. They're not black culture, they're not Somali culture, it's any culture, because we're supposed to represent whatever's in the school. Our last slide, it asks you this. Go through the six now. And I want you to say to your neighbor, answer this question, am I culturally responsive? When you look at the six, all right? Am I culturally responsive? Just turn to your neighbor, yes or no, am I culturally responsive? I know it's a hard question to answer. Let me give you the answer. I'm getting there. I'm getting there. All right. I know some of y'all on precise time. I got 8:25, so I want to save 5 minutes for questions and answer, right? So I know I had a question from you, sir. Okay, good. He said I answered the question. But just for the sake that you had us thinking that you had a question, could you just go ahead and ask us the question? Right. Yes. Yes. Right. Right.
There are not very many different races there.
Right.
Given that kind of makeup, I was thinking that it was indeed possible to identify behavioral norms for the country that ties into the race. But the more I thought about it, it's not necessarily the race, because if I look at Africa and kind of extrapolate there and just use the same framework I use for India, it right. doesn't kind of work. So
yep, exactly, exactly. Yeah, and you got it, and you're exactly right. Another question, comment? Yes.
What are some history books that you're comfortable with or familiar with or would encourage young people read that would be a little bit more culturally sensitive?
None, in terms of textbook companies, okay. right? So what we promote in terms of history is original sources, that students go to the original sources, read it, be critical thinkers, critical analyzers for themselves, so that they're not dependent on the institutional knowledge. Now, I threw out somebody like Malefe Asante, who has an African or Afrocentric history textbook that the Philadelphia schools adopted, many years ago. So if you want to, we could think of it like that. But if you ask me, what would be a textbook that I think that I would say, because of the textbook industry, and they have to get adopted by states like Texas, there's not one I would throw out. I just would send people to we read the original sources, the Frederick Douglass and all the people who've made the history, in essence. Yeah. Someone else? There we go.
How would this translate to a child that is in Edina right now that is African-American, in my child's case, biracial, that is one of very few students in their school, and for the most part, having a very good experience, but sometimes there are occasions where they feel different than, maybe not appreciated, or even if it's something not explicitly stated to them, they just feel different than. Right. What can the school district do to help those students in this situation?
Well, I think that three things. One is we're trying to create a hypersensitivity among all educators in Edina, that we don't make any assumptions about any student. And I've worked with them about turning on their cultural lens to look for those subtle things that you're talking about and not just go for the obvious, right? Also, as it applies to biracial, you know, it's very important that we understand that even though a child is biracial, typically they're gonna take on a cultural norm, right, depending on how much of the house is bicultural. Does that make sense? And you probably understand what I'm saying, right? And so we know kids who are biracial, let's say from a in terms of African-American and Caucasian, right? But if the home subscribes to more of a whiteness culture, then those biracial students, they tend to get less issues because they basically come in their quote-unquote whiteness. But if they subscribe to a black culture and they're biracial, then they get a little more heat. So we have to be hypersensitive to that, right? Because, you know, those students feel marginalized in both ways, and so it's very important. So my answer to you is to say, we've asked the teachers to have your radars on and then validate and affirm. Yeah. As parents, in terms of working with the schools, okay, she said as parents. So it's important that you teach, I think it's important that you emphasize biculturalism with your children, right? And that it's important for them, the whole notion of the situational appropriateness, I think has a more meaningful application when students are coming from homes that are bicultural, right? They feel like they have more in essence, right? Similar to being bilingual in essence. I find that a lot of parents, they want to shy away. And some will say, well, I'm trying to let them make the choice. Well, you know, they're children, right? And kids are going to learn from what they get in the home. So why not teach them, you know, to be bicultural in terms of who they are, and then be able to express that with students and friends and teachers as well. Yeah. Yes.
I just wanted to greet you with Anishinaabe. I just want to give honor first to the fact that we're on Dakota land and that we do have Native American students in this district and that they are not always recognized that way and that there are lots of cultural pieces that happen every day in school that make the kids very uncomfortable. And I think that although it is a small population, I think it's something that we need to really think about, especially when we sit on Dakota land.
Yes.
To really think about how do we move forward in helping the invisible students really feel honored in their culture.
Yes. Awesome. Awesome. Yes. You know what? Okay. I was going to quit while we're ahead, but go ahead. Go ahead.
I'm just wondering, in your rings of culture, where do children with special needs fit in?
Good. Great question. They fit in, right? The only reason why it's not a ring, quote unquote, is because I've tied the rings to anthropological research. However, it is a ring, it is a culture, and special needs teachers, they respond very well to this approach. Because you have to be this way to have success in special education. There's no way around it, right? So it's what I call, it's an invisible ring, or it's there, but because I'm making, if you come to the full training, I'm making specific references to specific research tied to each of the rings. So that's why I don't include it as a quote unquote official ring. But we do talk about it in our trainings, yes. Okay, here comes the boss. So that means he's walking into me, so he's got to go. Thank you, Edina, so much.
Sharroky Hollie. There were many places you could have been tonight. And I look at all of us out here, and we are gassed. We have been going all day, and you made a commitment to be here today. And that speaks to our community. That speaks to us making a difference. That speaks to us. Sharroky spent a day of working a classroom in and out, in and out, in and out, and he still was committed to coming here tonight, too. So we are committed to this work. And my challenge to you as you go out the door, greet somebody you didn't know today. Give them a vab. The other thing I'd ask you to do is people who weren't here, let them know that this is going to be online so that they have an opportunity to hear the story, to hear the learning from Sharroky Hollie, because he is a man that's making a difference not only here in our community, but throughout the United States. And we are very fortunate to have Sharroky partnering with us. I can't say enough, and so on behalf of the school district, thank you for coming out. On behalf of our young people, thank you for being here tonight, and thank you. Drive safely. Have a great evening, everybody. Thank you.